I would like to give a slight impulse on the connection between the cheap oil and the end of cheap oil and the consequences on transportation. And I want to start with a picture I found from Budinski, which reminds me somehow of the beginning of the exploitation of oil. And it reminds me also on the energy intensity of oil. So we were and we are still fascinated of what is all possible of oil and of the production of goods beyond oil. So we saw this slide, or this part of the slide, tomorrow morning from Professor Kummer. We see that in the beginning, at the 18th and 19th century, the prices for crude oil went down, maybe for increased and better technology of exploitation. But maybe we now know it was the beginning of the end. So what the people did not recognize that there will be, that it is an endless or limited resource we're dealing with. But the problem is that we built in this area or in this time scale in the 19th and 20th century an economic system which is built on the illusion that we are dealing with an unlimited resource of oil. So this is, maybe you can put everything behind this exponential curve. You know the topics about peak everything. So it's not only GDP growth and the growth of resource consumption and water consumption and so on. So this is the main problem. We are talking about an economic system, and we heard it in the presentation before. We are also already, or we are meanwhile talking about economic growth. And these economic theories, as we all know, were built on the illusion of the unlimited oil. I like the question before, which asked about substitution of trips outside the house, so how we are possible to make mobility in a more efficient or in a better way. And if we take a look at the world oil production, or you can say our energy consumption, then we ask ourselves, okay, were the people mobile? Did they travel in the timeline before the 20th or the 19th century? Were they mobile? What would you say? Yes, they were mobile in a way, but the mobility was quite different. We all know it was partly physical mobility with body energy, and of course it was mental energy, body energy. And there's an old Austrian saying which states that one who does not have it in the brain has to have it in his feet. So you see, there's a connection between mental mobility and of course physical mobility. And with this enormous amount of energy we have because of oil and the usage of oil, we were able to substitute a lot of our body energy. We were pedestrians, we were cyclists and so on, by physical external energy. And you see our mental energy went down on a very low level. And that's our problem today. So we're getting more, we're talking about efficiency the whole time, but in reality we're getting more and more inefficient because we need more and more energy to do things we did the years and the thousand years before at the same time. We went to work, we went go to education and so on. So if we talk about mobility, we have to talk about the purposes of the trips, of course, because otherwise we're talking about useless mobility, and that's the same, of course, when we talk about the transportations of goods. Do we need, what do we need, and so on. So I'm very thankful of the questions from Dennis Meadows before. You all know these scenarios which talk about the increase of oil in an in amount between doubling the price or much above. But it's not a matter of time when this will be and when this will happen. So it's a matter of what we will do that it does not happen, or what strategies we can use for transportation. That's also a problem, the energy consumption in transport. You all know that the most part is going to the road sector. So when we talk about the problems of transportation, and it's, you saw it before at the presentation from Jeremy, that the huge problems are in the road sector concerning the energy consumption. That's also true for Austria. You see this slide ends 1995, but we're still increasing, which I show you in the next slide. So we're now in the transport sector, here the second column at the level above 350 petajoule per year, which is the energy consumption of the transport, and all based on crude oil, of course, or oil. So when we talk oil, and especially oil in transportation, when we say, as I said before, when we talk about transportation, we have to talk about the purposes of the trips. So don't, if that we don't talk about useless transportation, we very quickly come to this thing that crude oil is a public good, and it should belong to all people all time. So it's a question of values, of course, and the question what price do we pay at the gas station today, and what should be paid. And maybe one approach is quite important, that if we go back to the slide where we see physical mobility related to body energy and mental mobility based on body energy, we have to say one joule is one joule. And then we take the energy intensity in 1 liter of crude oil into account and compare it to our body energy. So we know if we use 1 liter gas for adequate distance of 10 to 20 kilometers if we travel by car. And if we compare it with a pedestrian, he needs for this distance, well, let's say 2.5 to 5 hours. And let's say we pay him an hourly rate of 10 euros. And you compare it with the fuel price, we had to say that 25 to 50 euros per liter gas were at least justifiable. But what we forget, that the car has a weight from 1 to 2 tons. So we have to employ a lot more people to go at least the speed of a pedestrian. So maybe we have to pay 3 or 4 people. So you see there is a distortion of a factor of 1 to 100 and above, of course. So in a real system, we have to pay 1 joule for 1 joule. And that's the basis for becoming a price reality, even in the energy sector and, of course, in the transport sector. That was stressed a lot of time before, the reference scenario from the Club of Rome. If we talk about transportation, we, of course, have to talk about the limits of growth, not also in the good transportation sector, but also in the passenger transport sectors. We know this model fit very well to the actual development, especially regarding the reference scenario. So there isn't this illusion of exponential growth, and this illusion is also related long time in the transport sector, and is still in the head of a few transport experts, so-called transport experts. But this is based on this unlimited growth and the exploitation of natural resources, and of course misleading indicators. So we, when we talk about economic growth, we talk about an indicator of GDP, which is definitely based on crude oil and the exploitation of crude oil. But you will see that this is more or less, it has to be an illusion regarding the second sentence of thermodynamic. So if we compare this external consumption per trip for different means of transportation, and you see I do not use the indicator related to the length of the trip, because the length of the trip is a function of the speed, which I will show a little bit later. But for the trip itself, related to the purpose of the trip, and you see that we not only talk about the energy consumption in use of the means of transportation, but also regarding the production. A car is not born, we all know that, it's produced, and we need a lot of resources for the production of the car. So we talk about peak everything. You see, we're not only talking about oil, but if you produce a car, you need, for instance, 300,000 liters of water, and so on. I could give you some more examples, but we're talking about much more limits of resources. So the transport planners, they had this in mind in the 50s and 40s and 50s in the last century, when they started to build the motorways and the infrastructure we all have outside in our countries. And they assumed, okay, well, there's a production of oil and so on, and we will have oil for use for the future, and started to build car infrastructure. What they do now, where we are familiar with this development, they copy these strategies of building motorways and infrastructure for a certain means of transportation and paste it to the year 2005. And you will see that it doesn't really fit into the development and the development of the boundary conditions. So we have to make decisions, or we have to get new ideas and think mobility in a new way, And this is, of course, based on pedestrian, cyclists, and public transportation issues. That's the problem. Why are we not able to cope with these issues? Why are we so? Why do we stick so intensely to the car? And that's why we're fascinated because of the speed. So we are, know we are 6 to 8 million on our feet by ourselves. We are pedestrians. We are walking around our surroundings. And then suddenly we were able, because of oil, to get to drive very, very fast. This seems increasingly nice if you sit in the car and you're able to move yourself very fast without using body energy, more or less. But it has enormous consequences on the system. And that's maybe also related to the questions before. What can we do to reduce our travel distances? And not only our travel distance, but also the distances we transport the goods around the globe. And they were going back to the old researchers from Zahavi. They started in the early 80s. And you see that he found out that the daily travel time per traveler does not differ if they have zero cars in the household or if they have two or more cars in the household. So people have the same amount of travel time they use, but they travel longer distances, which you can see on the vertical axis here. This service, they were repeated in the 80s from Schaffer et al. From several countries around the globe. So they showed that there was no possibilities or no travel time saving was observed. So no matter if the people had cars and or if they had no cars and were pedestrians, they had the same amount of travel time, and they used this, of course, for trips regarding some purposes. So if we travel faster, then we travel longer distances. So if we talk about reducing our travel distances, we have to talk of the reducing the speed. Not only the speed in the transport of the physical transport sector, but also talking about the transport sector regarding internet and regarding the transportation of information, which is a quite important issue regarding the financial sector. We are able to switch millions and billions and unlimited sums of money around the globe without resistance, which is not possible in a real system. By pressing one key on our computer, we can switch some billion dollars from one country on the world to another. So it's a complete unreal system. If you think back, I mean, they would be robbed out from the pirates in the 14th century. It was not able in the history. But now we're able. Of course, that's one reason of the exponential growth of the financial sector. It's also an issue of the transport system. It's also a transport system. Just give you an example of the difference between our view and what is true and the system view, which can be completely different. This right, this left, from your side, this left diagram, we all experience that when we sit in the car and we know we drive with the four or fifth gear and we drive between 70 or 90 kilometers per hour, we use less fuel. That's all experience that's true from our point of view. But in the system, you see, because of the possibility of saving time, it's following an exponential growth curve, which is completely different to the left diagram. So this is the system point of view. There's the indicator fuel consumption kilometer per hour, per time scale. And in the other side, it's per length. So we have to deal, if we talk about the global and about systems, and as a system researcher, we have to deal with, of course, the right-hand side. But do not forget the left-hand side to take and to argue and to make arguments for the politicians. So that's what we all know, and that's what we experience, and that's how the system works. We talked about efficiency, and the whole morning today, this word of efficiency was going around. But we are talking about efficiency for decades, and on the other hand, we see that the energy, not only the energy demand, but also the energy consumption is increasing. So we see it here in the transport sector is a good example. You all know the cars are getting slightly, they can reduce the fuel consumption a little bit, but what do the people do? They buy bigger cars. The SUVs in Vienna, they are a good example, and you see that the city is not it's not a mountain area. So there's an approved fuel rate for a given vehicle type, and on the other hand, we were failed to lower the fuel consumption per vehicle. And this diagram ends in the year 2005, and related to the transport sector, there was a beginning stagnation in that in 2005. I will come to that a little bit later. Another rebound effect is, for instance, if we talk about the cut down of oil use by a certain amount of percent, then the oil prices would come down by a certain amount of percent. But what would the people do? If the oil price gets down, they will start to drive more cars. That's the problem, what we built, the congestion infrastructure. And that's the structures. So we have the problem that there is a connection between the development of settlements and the cities and people moving to the cities, the development of megacities and so on, which is of course a question of putting resources into these megacities and the structures connected to this fossil trip. So of course it's not also a discussion about oil, but it's also a question of social problems. That's what I mentioned before. You see, beginning in 2005, and it was right before the so-called economic crisis, that there was a stagnation in the automobile use in several European countries. So not also in Germany and Australia and so on. So there was kind of a saturation. So the people, more or less, they do not drive more kilometers per year with the car, which is also, of course, not only a reason or an output of an increasing prices, not only oil, but also all the products related to the oil. In the U.S., you can see it was quite obvious, and the amount of traveled kilometers went down regarding the increasing oil price. We also talked about e-mobility and the possibilities to substitute maybe a little bit of our car mobility through another energy resource. You see that in China, the thing is completely different than in Austria, which has a complete other generation of electricity regarding to water power and so on, and China regarding to coal. So you see that we don't reach the emissions of gas and diesel right now. So the e-cars are just an alternative for a few use cases. We have to take that in mind, but of course not in general. So a substitution from one to another doesn't make sense. That's the preconditions for the planning, the sequences of priorities, pedestrian, of course, cycling, public transport, car traffic. And this is in accordance with all the goals on political level and, of course, also on the levels of the society in this way. So that's the problem. This is the structures we built out of our oil consumption and the oil exploitation. The possibilities are the challenges right now are to keep or to rebuild, resize, redimension, redesign these structures. So maybe we should use the energy we have to transform these buildings and these structures into more livable areas. You see, every city who tried to grow over a certain level collapsed. So this is only one example in the megacity discussions. We see, okay, on the one hand, we can reduce the energy per person if the people live in the big cities. But on the other hand, we do not calculate right now how we can put the resources into the city and how to keep up the transportation, of course, in these so-called mega cities. So they are, of course, carrying capacity, and I'm sure that Rome didn't focus on the carrying capacity at this level of time. So this is all built on crude oil. I will skip that. The economy is just another thing. We talked about that before, so you can decide for future if shopping should be this way or if it should be that way. So that's a question of the planners and their responsibility, of course, also in argumentation and talking to the politicians. And you see that this has also effects of the employment. So there's a direct connection between an interrelationship from the transport sectors with a lot of other disciplines, which is not educated very well till right now in the universities. But these interconnections are, and they are obvious. So you see, we can employ 5 times more people in the inner city, in the small scale inner city structures than we can employ at the large scale suburban structures. So that's what we talked before, it's a question of indicators. So coming to the last slide, it's a matter of paradigm change. We did it in Vienna decades ago, and the good public transport system right now is a result of this long-term strategy, and it's a question of structures. So the people behave how the structures are like. It's not only physical, but it's also mental, and it's also financial structures. And if you begin to change these structures at the right point of time, you have, of course, the possibilities to satisfy the people. And then maybe the people also see that that it's not so difficult that to change the behavior, even if they're afraid right before. So there are a lot of things to go. This is a typical street in Vienna. There are right now public buses and so on. And we want to redesign and reorganize this city for this street as an example only into this design. So if we talk about, of course, peak oil and the end of cheap oil, we have to talk about redesign and reorganization of the cities, of the demolition of antiquated infrastructure like they did in Seoul. There was a highway which was removed. On this highway, there were nearly 200,000 vehicles per day, and they removed it, and there's now a river, and the people have the possibility to go there and to meet friends and so on. In the US, there are several examples where they removed the highways because they destroyed the cities and so on, beginning in the early 70s. So if you check out the internet, there are some good examples where you can see when the people realized they are not happy with this kind of structures, they try to convince the politicians, of course, to make post-oil structures, as I mentioned here, for human beings. Last slide. This positive trend in Vienna, which can be an example for other cities, when we talk especially about the increasing number of people moving to the city. On the horizontal axis, you see the change of car license or of cars in Vienna. And on the vertical slide, you see the increase of population or decrease in Vienna. And the red dots there in the timeline between 1991 and 2001 and the blue one between 2002 and 2008. And you see that it completely changed. We had in Vienna in this period before 2000 an increasing number of cars, and in a lot of districts, these are the numbers of the districts, 23 districts in Vienna, and less and less people, especially in the inner city districts. The people moved with their car outside the city. And it radically changed after 2000, maybe parallel to this process in other countries all over the world, to the saturation process of the automobile use. And then the people began to, and it's a process right now, began to move back to the cities and to have, and more people have less and less cars. So we have a reduction of numbers of cars, even absolute numbers in inner city districts. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Harold. So just time for a couple of quick questions before lunch, if there are any there.
Everyone's hungry.
I wanted to ask one thing about, or I guess one observation. You talked about that hourly rate that you're paying the people and therefore how much you can afford for fuel. You made a comment that it doesn't take into account that the vehicle is 2 tons and therefore the equation's even worse. I guess the obvious conclusion for me from that is that, well, we don't need a 2-ton vehicle to move one person to the city, so obviously the vehicle sizes have got to come down to the size we need for the task. I'll take one over that side. Yep.
Hi, Robert Hogtham from Yonkers, New York. How do you prevent Jevons' paradox from taking hold?
You mean this efficiency? Yeah. That's a good question. I think it's a matter of financiation and, of course, a matter of structures. Because if you redesign cities and if you redesign structures which do not take into account these rebound effects regarding the efficiency, I mean, you can't drive this SUV vehicle in a pedestrian zone. So, and even if you are a car addicted and you want to buy something inside the pedestrian zone because it has a good, better air quality and so on, you have to change your behavior, no matter of this rebound process. But of course, there are some other. If you take a look at the lighting process in the cities, so we have more and more lights because they are more and more efficient, and the people and the cities are getting more and more enlightened in a way. So that's also a difficult process. But I would say if we have to take account on the physical structures and talk so much about this efficiency stuff.
So it's more about creating
an environment regarding
the infrastructure.
Yeah.
Needs to be shifted.
Of course, yeah. Regarding the future boundary conditions, because we can't solve the problem. The efficiency process and the thinking of efficiency is, to my opinion, is out of a thinking we had before. We did these problems because of our way of thinking. And maybe I think we are not able to solve the problems with this way of, the old way of thinking, if you want. Maybe we have to talk about a new way of thinking. And to my opinion, efficiency is not a new way of thinking. It's part of the process and we have to talk about it and we have, of course, to deal with it in a way, but it will not solve the problem of reducing energy consumption. Maybe we don't have to talk about efficiency because the problem will be solved by the crashing of the resources and the limits of the resources, of course.
So I'd like to give a couple of different people an opportunity as well. I'll take one at the back here and one here, and then I might have to let everybody else catch you at lunch. So right at the back.
Yeah, thank you. Just a very short question. How strong is the car industry in Austria in terms of produced volumes and compared to industry for public transport vehicles? Is there an...
It's not the direct car industry because we have no big car industries in Austria, but we have a delivery industry to the car industry, especially in Germany and in other countries. I don't have the numbers in detail in mind, but... There's a problem that we have a huge amount of people in the public transport sectors, which has enormous branches in different levels, which are not where we are not so able to directly connect it to the public transport industry. But it's more people than they are employed in the public transport sector, directly or indirectly, compared to the directly or indirectly car industry, delivery car industry.
You can pursue that one as well. We'll take one last question here.
Yeah, that's Christoph Kiener. I got the same question as Werner Zittel had, and maybe a little bit more direct. So you recommend to buy or to have a nation with less cars?
Yes.
Yeah. And of course, that's easier for Austria than for a politician which comes from Wolfsburg.
But I don't know. If you take a look at the last weeks in the discussion of moving Opel from Rüsselsheim, I think, to help me, he wants to Opel will wants to produce Astra not longer in Rüsselsheim, but he wants to move the production in another city inside Austria. And there was in the past big discussions. So the question is, do I want to get as a politician in such dependency of a large corporation? And this is not only related to the car industry, but we're talking about big corporations, big transnational corporations at all, in general, where I have the problem that if they don't get the cheap workers, they quickly move to another country like parasites. So if I am a politician, I would say, okay, I have a lot of people in a lot of different small corporations, because if something happens to one of these smalls, it's much more resilient in a way than I have 2,000 people in a big car or whatever corporation employed. And when this one says, okay, I'm going, then it's going, or you pay a lot of taxpayers' money into this corporation, which doesn't make sense at all.
So once you have them, of course, you are stuck in the problem somehow.
Of course, that's the problem, yes.
In general, I think the questions on all these meetings are, how can we make more money with selling less?
That's, no.
Or how can we continue an economy with selling less?
That's not, no, that's the old thinking. The question in the new economy is not regarding selling and is not regarding money in the old style. If we have these terms and talking about more money and selling more goods, then we don't get the focus. So I know it's a challenge. And I mean, there's these old examples regarding Jean Ziegler. If you talk to him, and he always says, if you ask the people in the French Revolution how their perspective and what do they expect at the end of the revolution, what is the new political system they want, they had no answer. So maybe a little bit it's the same. There was this question mark on the right-hand side of this world oil production and consumption. We do not exactly know, but we know the problems and we have to discuss the problems, and this is right, just one of the problems you addressed.
I'm going to hold it there. I don't want to stand between a room full of people and their lunch. I'm sure that Harold, Stefan and Jeremy will all be available up the front here to continue the discussions that have started. I'd ask you to thank them all for the presentations they've given.